We're going to start by opening up PI System Management Tools. That's called PI SMT. You'll find it under Program Files, PI System, and this is called PI System Management Tools. Now we're going here because we start in the module database, and this is where the module database editor is found. And I will choose under the SMT menu, Operation, and then Module Database. I'll make this a little bigger. Now, if we traverse through the module database, this is our asset database for tracking assets or giving you a kind of an asset-based view and navigation tool for your system. And what we want to do is we want to make this a reactor there, a batch reactor. Now, you'll notice in the Learning Lab environment, we already have configured Reactor 3, this module, to be a PI unit module. That's what we're trying to do here in this first step. We're trying to take an existing module and we're going to convert it to a module that will be used for batch. And with that assignment, it's also how we're going to associate the unit name with these batches and also the aliases that are associated with those batches. Now, it's already been done in your environment, so let me demonstrate how you would do it if you didn't have this environment. This is an exact duplicate of Reactor 3. It's got concentration, temperature, or tank level and temperature as aliases, but it hasn't been configured yet to be a PI unit module. And we do that by choosing to edit it and just setting this is PI unit switch. Now by turning that on, what it does is it indicates that we're going to be using this for batch records. So that's our first step. Now a second step is to just take a look around and see what the different tools are that you can use with batch. So we're going to be concentrating on Reactor 3. Notice that if we go into this section here on interfaces, into this section on batch, we can take a look at the batch generator applet. And with that batch generator applet, we can also search for these units. So you can see this MDB view gives us a view of the module database. We could actually have created these modules right here and then created them as PI batch modules through this interface. However, if you are interested in creating these aliases, you do have to do that in the module database editor. Our next step is to set up something that we're calling the configuration module name for the PyBGen interface in general. Now, this is something that only needs to be done once. It needs to be done up here at the top of this batch generator section. It only needs to be done once for a server, not once per unit. So once for each server, you would need to set up this. It's the configuration module name. And it's done at the root level of this this module database view or under registered units. These two tabs are two different ways of looking at the configuration of units for tracking batches. But in either case, you choose this top level, and this is where you go, or this is how you then go and specify this configuration module name. So what is the configuration module name? Well, simply put, it's the name that we are going to assign to a module that's created in each registered batch unit to store the PyBGen configuration for that unit. So let me demonstrate. See, if we go back to our module database here, I mentioned earlier that this has already been set up in this particular exercise, but it hasn't been registered yet. Once we register this PI unit module here, once we register that, you're going to notice that there's a brand new hierarchy organized underneath this Reactor 3 South. That hierarchy is going to be named PyBGen. It's going to be named a module PyBGen, and then there will be aliases underneath that. That's where we store the configuration information for PyBGen for this particular PI unit module. So what have we done by naming this PyBGen? Well, it simply means that that's going to be the name of the module that we create in each PI unit batch that will contain the configuration information for this particular interface. And as I mentioned, it only needs to be done once per PI server. Now, in the case of the Learning Lab environment, it's already been done, so you don't need to do that. And I hope it's not belaboring the obvious, but just to illustrate what I'm talking about, let's take a look at our existing registered units. If I go into the module database and look for these digesters, you should see underneath them there is a module called, well, no surprise, it's called PyBGen. So that's what we're talking about. We're naming the name that it will be assigned to this module, and there will be a module called that name for each one of these units. And that module is used, it's used by the PyBGen interface to actually specify those things that need to be specified for how it's generating these batches. Let's move on now to actually define this new reactor 3 South. Let's define what type of batch records we're going to get. The first thing we need to specify is the name of the active point. This is going to be the trigger tag whose value changes will trigger when a batch starts and when that batch ends. Now notice that I'm working within a section called Pi unit batches. We also support sub-batches and just Pi batches in general. You know, this is a lower on the hierarchy, this is higher on the hierarchy. We're going to, in this example, use Pi unit batches. And so let's configure this the way it's shown in your step-by-step solution and in your approach. We're going to use the tag ba:active.1. Now I could just as easily, instead of typing it in like that, I could have just gone out using the tag search, look for all the tags that begin with the letter BA, and found that active tag. Now this is a tag that takes an active and an inactive state. It goes active when a batch starts. It goes inactive when the batch stops. So that's what we would call pulse behavior. It's going to go, you know, active, and that's the batch, inactive, and no batch. Now that's different than something that might be, for example, like a batch ID, in which each time the batch ID changes, it increments a new batch, or it indicates a new batch. That would be a step tag. So we're going to choose pulse in this case. And let's just fill out the rest of these. These are going to be the tags whose value will be interrogated at the time that this active tag triggers. So when the active tag triggers, we evaluate the names or the values of the tags that we place here, and then it's those values that we will put into the batch records. So the ones we had chosen here, we have a ba:batch ID that we've set up in this Learning Lab environment. We also have a ba:product name. That's going to be what we get for the product name. And for the procedures, ba:recipe. Now, like when you work with most pieces of software, there's all kinds of bells and whistles you can choose here. So let's take a look at some of them. First of all, there's an evaluation delay. What this means is in seconds, we will delay from the triggering of the active tag until we actually evaluate the values of these tags. So for example, if the active tag triggers, but you want to give it 15 seconds for these values to become up to date, then you can just put the number 15 here. Well, in this case, we don't want that. We're just going to be using 0. Now, compare that to this. Evaluate at the end of each unit batch. What this will do is, if it's chosen, then we don't assign batch ID, product name, etc. anytime during when the batch is running. It's only when the batch ends that we will interrogate the value of this and assign the appropriate values. Now this merge consecutive here, when turned on, what this means is if you have, for example, well, let's say you have a tag that goes active and then it becomes inactive. So you would think that the batch is over, right? But actually the batch is just paused. And then it goes active again without any of the values in these tags changing. If that happens, and specifically the batch ID, when merge consecutive is turned on, we will simply assume that that those two batches that would show up as two batches are in fact one batch that just had a pause in the middle. I'm not going to use that in this example. And this just controls the verbosity of how many debug messages you might get. Now I'm also going to choose a recovery option. It says we're going to recover all Pi batch objects going back 1 day. Now what this means, and I can also specify Pi batches and Pi unit batches. I think for this example, I'll go ahead and choose Pi unit batches as well. What we should see is when we first register this is going to go back and actually look at the or interrogate the old data and then generate batch records that would have triggered if this had been configured, you know, going back one day. Now, I'm pretty sure we're not going to get great results in this particular example because my particular virtual machine's only been running about an hour, but we should be able to generate some unit batches. And depending on, you know, how long your virtual machine's been running here, you may or may not see any results there. So that concludes the configuration that's required for this, the PI unit batches. Next up is to do some configuration for capturing sub-batch information.